Hey everyone, thanks for listening to Word Made Digital. I'm your host, Joanna LaFleur, and today we have episode 5 with Jon Thompson. He is my own pastor at C4 Church. Now, Jon is a theologian, he's a pastor, he's a thinker, he has a doctorate in missiology, and he has a lot to say about art and communication and creativity in the church. So I have the privilege of serving with him on the staff of C4 Church, which is in the suburbs of Toronto. It's a multi-site church, and Jon has been one of the senior leaders and a teaching pastor for many years now at the church. His title has changed a bit over time, but he has been really one of the leaders of the church ever since actually I was in the youth group in the early 2000s. So we're starting a conversation way back in the day, how he and I together learned to do ministry together, and actually how he, as my youth pastor, invited me on to do communications as a really young person. Lots of youthful enthusiasm, but maybe not so much skill. So we're going to talk about that. But really, the heart of the conversation we're having is around theology and art. Why does it matter that artists and creatives in the church have a theological foundation? Why does it matter that their art is actually accurate theologically? We're going to be looking at the visual culture that we live in. Obviously, images are huge for us today. So how do we balance that with what we know of the history of the church and how images can become an idol for us? So how do we do that as creatives in the church? We're going to look at the original meaning of word made flesh out of John 1, which is where the title of this whole podcast comes from, Word Made Digital or Word Made Flesh. And so I can't wait to dive into this. Thanks everyone for listening to this podcast, sharing it, telling other people. I love that you guys are enjoying this. So keep on sending in your comments and your feedback. And without any more to do, let's dive in with Jon Thompson.
You're listening to the Word Made Digital podcast with Joanna LaFleur, where we discuss all things creative and communications for the church. The church carries the best news in the world, so we want to help you be the best creatives and communicators in the world. Let's go.
All right, Jon, thanks so much for joining me today on the podcast. This podcast is called Word Made Digital. It's all about communications in our times. What does communications look like in the digital age? And it's a conversation around creativity, communications, media, technology. And what better person to address that than a theologian?
Everybody.
And so as a pastor, as an academic, as a theologian, I'd love to dive into a little conversation with you today about what this looks like from your perspective. Sure. And so I'd like to start just, can you introduce yourself a little bit? Who are you? Sure. What's your context?
Yeah, so my name is Jonathan Thompson, and I am the preaching and vision pastor at a church called C4, which we both work at and are connected to. And my primary responsibility is strategic oversight, sort of next steps. It's not the implementation side of thing, it's preaching, it's vision, it's, I suppose the word we jokingly use sometimes is cultural architect. So yeah, that's my role here.
Right. And so you didn't start here though. I mean, you've been in ministry for a long time. Mm-hmm. And mainly here at this particular church at C4 Crothers Creek Community Church.
Yeah, 20 years.
And so where did you start? What's your beginnings in ministry? I mean, maybe even you want to say about where you were as a kid.
Sure. So I mean, I'm fourth or fifth generation Christian. So I come from a long line of followers of Jesus from a lot of backgrounds. And I've come to value that a lot. I don't view that as a negative, but a profound gift and positive. My parents were missionaries, so before I was born, they were with Operation Mobilization all through Europe. Then I was born, we hung out here. Then I grew up in the 80s in Ecuador with HGB. So I had sort of like the, you know, National Geographic experience as a child before the digital age, right? So before you could just access everything, I got to do that. And then moved back here. And a lot of history in a lot of places. I've been to over 40 countries now.
And how were you communicating in the jungles? How did you communicate back home, or do you remember any of that?
I do. So not the jungles. We were actually in the volcanoes.
The volcanoes.
Yeah, 10,000 feet above sea level.
Okay.
Yeah, crazy. So like my memories of Ecuador as a kid in the 80s were like paying $10 US in 1985 for Cheese Whiz, as an example. Just think about that.
$10 US in 85. Yeah. So that's like, $30 today $40 for a jar. Yeah. Cheese.
To talk to my grandparents, we would phone on a landline to a CB operator in Texas.
Okay.
Who would take his, somehow a landline, and we would talk to my grandparents in Toronto through a CB radio.
Like, wow.
That crazy.
So CB radio to phone line somehow.
To phone lines. I didn't know how it happened.
But yeah, amazing. Yeah, I mean, I know as a kid who grew up abroad as well for a period of time, it was in the early 90s when we were really excited about fax machines.
Yeah, that's right.
That was the latest and greatest at the time. And we heard about this thing called email, but we didn't really, we didn't have it.
Right.
We knew others who had it. It was like this secret it was a secret club that we could not participate in ourselves. But, you know, phoning home was a big deal. And you know, doing cross-cultural ministry in a context of not really being able to have a lot of contact with home at the time was
tough.
Was a challenge, and it was better than it had ever been. Yet it was still very difficult and expensive to connect back home.
Big time.
And I think that also maybe allowed us to be a bit more present where we were.
Yep.
Because we just weren't able to be at home.
That's right.
Every day we weren't on FaceTime or whatever. And so, yeah, so you and I met, I believe it was 1999.
That sounds right. Yeah.
And it was here at C4 Church, or it was Crothers Creek Community Church, and you were the youth pastor.
I was.
And I was a youth.
You were a youth, yes.
I was a 13 or 14-year-old kid
when
we met, and I began coming to the youth group. And so tell us a little bit about what that was. There was a very unique thing happening in the youth group at the time, and then you and I began to get involved doing some ministry stuff together.
So I became the youth pastor in 1998, and the youth group was like 20 kids maybe, and then over a period of a few years it exploded, and God just did some unbelievable things. And not just in this youth group, actually in this whole area. There was definitely a baby boom, so you can actually trend it, but beyond that, there was just a mass desire for teenagers to know Jesus, connect with Jesus, and hang out with him. And you were one of those kids who was in the middle of that.
Yeah.
And it went from like 20 to 50 to 80 to 100. I remember before we had this building that you and I are actually podcasting in right now, we were renting a United Church for a bit because we needed space. Then we moved in here and just kept growing. So it was pretty amazing.
Yeah. And the youth group was like the size of my high school, basically.
Yeah, it was wild.
Yeah.
Yeah. And we were, I mean, the memories I have of this were like, I mean, I was running communion services in the middle of public high schools.
Yeah.
And the teachers allowed it. And I had 120 kids at Pine Ridge High School taking communion, laying hands on kids, people becoming Christians. It was just unheard of in this youth group and multiple other youth groups.
Yeah. And so, you know, enter where we began working together. And I mean, I worked for you. I was a kid and you were the pastor.
Yeah.
And I guess that's still the case. You are the pastor and I work for you. So we began doing communication stuff. Tell me what you remember about communications in the context of this sort of revival youth group days. What do you remember of that?
Well, I remember that there's always a tension between two audiences because you always want to continue to engage seekers and skeptics and Muslims and Hindus and everyone who's not a Christian. And yet, as a youth pastor, you got to care for the Christian kids and then all the needs of the parents. So it's always complicated.
Yeah. That's true. The parents are also a layer in the youth group.
Well, they are. And now I'm a parent of three kids. I have a deeper appreciation for both sides of the conversation. But I think the heart of it is I just knew that one of the best ways we needed to not continue momentum, but just keep people involved was you needed to inform people and invite people and be relational. And so some of my early memories is I just said, well, we need to start committing to like literally calling people. And I think that's one of your and my early memories where
We had a
calling team.
Like to the home phone, the landlines.
Landline in the ancient times. And we would get like 15 or 18 kids, teenagers, maybe he was 10, and we'd take over every single phone because cell phones were still, even at that moment, present but expensive.
Yeah.
So we'd take over every phone line in the church and we would call every single teenager every 2 weeks to personally invite them.
Yeah.
And we noticed every time we did it that the numbers would go up if you called them and went down if you didn't.
That's it. And sometimes it helped if you talked to their mom.
Yeah, that's, or dad, absolutely.
Yeah, you know, you get their parent on the line, yep. And the parent, you know, makes little Mikey get to youth group, and, yep. And maybe little Mikey is glad he got there once he got there. But no, we saw a real transformation in people by a simple phone call invitation.
Absolutely.
I remember doing, you know, there were posters and video. Do you remember the video news?
I do. It was the very first video news ever done in this church.
Yes.
And I can't even imagine the size of the cameras now. I'm sure they were huge.
And very expensive,
and very
I'm
expensive.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah, we did that. And it was.
And we had a green screen.
We did have a green screen. And it was also the first time we even did joke videos. Like, we did a whole thing. Do you remember we did a video on sex before marriage? And we did this whole thing
with Ken and Barbie.
Ken and Barbie. Yeah. And then God's hand came down. No.
No.
And separated them. Like, now, we laugh at that now. But all that stuff, when you were 14, 15, 16, was actually the foundation of a culture in this church of believing in technology as a core value. And one of the wild things in our church, for you who are listening, is I used to teach when I was running the youth group that you can change the heart of the church from the sidelines, that the youth ministry wasn't this independent thing. You could actually prepare for the future by working out stuff on the sidelines in the youth ministry. And what's wild is, if you actually look at our church today, and Joe, you would know this, prayer ministry, communications, theology, so much that we worked on then and we had no clue what we were doing.
Style of worship.
It's now the epicenter of this church. Now, it's in a much more mature sense.
Yeah, it's the 2018 version, but...
But
yeah.
Its roots, and
yeah,
even the
that's
amount of
true.
Staff that
yeah.
are on, you know, come from those days.
Yeah, so let's talk about it. I mean, that's really the heart of the conversation for us. Art, media,
yep.
technology.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about it sort of for you as an academic, as from a theological approach. Why do these things matter? Why from those youth group days, from our early days of serving together in this church, why has that been part of it from the beginning?
Well, a few reasons. In my own history, my father is a fine artist.
Right.
So I grew up with a dad who, though he was in visual media in the sense of like graphic arts, he's actually a semi-well-known fine artist.
Yeah.
And so,
I mean, I can't afford his work. We'll put it that way.
Nor can I.
Yeah, I mean, your dad's work is seen in galleries and homes
around
the world.
Actually,
I think.
Around the world now.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. So I grew up with a father who taught me the value of art, the value of color, the value of beauty. And his sacred pathway very much is through aesthetics and nature. It's not necessarily my sacred pathways, but I grew up in that. So, I mean, you know, people jokingly ask me, John, what's your favorite color? It's not blue, it's turquoise. And there's a reason why it's turquoise, because
yeah.
I grew up with a father like that, right?
Yeah.
So
there are many kinds of blue.
There are many. It's
yeah.
Yeah, that's right. So why is it valuable? Because I also have a theological worldview that says that beauty and art aren't bad. We're evangelicals, we're Protestant here, and yet we would say that art, a lot of the art that was thrown out in the Reformation because it was a response to Catholicism, we're not part of the family
right.
in that sense. We're not afraid of art here. We're not afraid of technology. We don't think it takes away from Scripture, its authority at all. Actually, we think it sets the tone, it sets the table all the time for the greater conversation.
Right. And so, yeah, let's dive more into that. You know, there was a time where art was removed from a lot of Protestant churches.
Of course.
And some of those, that exists today. There are churches that would have a very bare, simple, maybe minimalist is maybe a better way of saying it, approach to their worship and their times together, their teaching. But that's fundamentally not what we would do.
No.
So talk about that. What do you think happens when people are engaging with art or creativity, whether that's in a service or personally,
sure.
and wherever you want to take
well,
that?
Well, first of all, I'll say that there's two types of churches. There are minimalist churches, and then there are, you know, maximal churches.
Yeah.
Bells and smells and pictures everywhere, right? A more
yeah.
Roman Catholic.
Stained glass and
right?
tapestries.
And all of it. And so there's dangers on both sides. The minimalist removes the beauty of God and says that art has no value because they're afraid that God's word is going to be undermined by that. And we would just go, No, that's a misunderstanding of sola scriptura. God's word is the ultimate source of, it's the Supreme Court, it's not the only court. Because right. within it, it talks about beauty, creation, art, gifts. So I find when I hang out with more conservative friends of mine who are part of the family, I just go, the very thing that you're defending, you're actually not listening to what it's saying. Mm. The other danger is art can become an idol. And that's true. That, you know, the Ten Commandments also have power into this, where you go, you know, you can be in a very beautiful environment and fall in love with the beauty and not ever meet the Jesus. Author of it all. Absolutely. Yeah. How many times have we heard people say, I grew up in a Roman Catholic or Anglican United Church and I loved the experience.
And the singing.
And the singing and the smell yeah. and the everything. But I never met him. And that's just as terrible.
Yeah.
So what we try to do here, with minimal resources, understanding that we've gone more digital in our art expression because of ability and art. We do have, obviously, artistic expression here, but it's been much more graphic digital than anything yeah. else.
And some of that has to do with cost.
That's what I mean. It's cost, it's money, it's time, it's ability. There's lots of things.
And also multi-site realities.
100%.
Of, you know, trying like at Easter this year, building something that was going to be physically at each location
right,
was costly and challenging logistically.
Correct.
But valuable.
Very
but
valuable.
We can't do that week by week.
Right. So we would just say we're trying to strike a very fine balance where art sets the table. Art gets you thinking. It also engages a type of person who might not be their sacred pathway might not be cognitive at first. Mm. And so, you know, one of the things I think we try to do well here is if you ever came to C4, our preaching is intense and intellectual and yet pastoral, and our worship is very charismatic in the sense of expression. And yet this art brings us counterbalance and it allows different learning styles to access the conversation.
Right.
And I think we're not in a post word age, but we are definitely in another moment like the Dark Ages where pictures have power again.
Right.
And so all the cathedrals were built to tell an illiterate community stories. I don't think we're illiterate, but whatever's happening now, and we all know it's happening, images are incredibly important to once again communicate the good news of Christ.
Right. And I guess it can go to the other extreme. I'm curious your observation theologically around the selfie culture and the obsession with image.
Yes.
You know, what is the danger zone for Christians in an age of visual? I mean, because in the past, when visuals were removed from churches, it was in a response to idolatry that people were worshiping the images
right.
and not the God they were trying to represent.
Right.
And so in the same way today in a visual culture, we're seeing, I mean, the classic social media Instagram selfie being the primary example, but it's in many things.
Sure.
What is the danger, do you think, for the church today in when imagery is so accessible and produced in massive, massive rates?
Yeah, a few things I would say. Number one thing I started doing as a personal self-discipline is before I post anything, I ask, why am I posting it?
Oh, I like that.
And so I start asking the question, am I doing this to promote myself? Do I actually honor Jesus in this? And actually, I found myself changing what I posted. Or I didn't change what I posted, but I made sure my worship was right before I posted it.
Mm.
And I think there's a huge spiritual self-discipline thing that has to happen among Christians, let alone Christian leaders. So that's the first thing. Second thing, I always ask the question, in a Christian context, are you posting it to glorify Christ or promote your church?
Mm.
Third of all, we all know that in a self-image-based culture with Instagram, everything looks perfect somewhere else, which becomes almost this cycle of self-hate that psychologists are talking about. And I want to make sure that what we promote, you and I talk about this all the time, what we promote on social media at C4 is actually true.
Yeah.
So if it's on social media, it's a true thing. It's not a glamorized thing. It's not an exacerbated thing. It is.
Yeah. If there were empty seats.
There are empty seats.
There are empty seats.
Correct. So this whole idea of always filming it in a certain direction so it always looks something else.
Yeah.
I think we need to get okay with everything not looking beautiful all the time.
Hmm.
So I think there's some, I think the spiritual disciplines, and actually the biggest thing theologically, Jesus says, you know, only those things that we do for the Father last into eternity and everything else burns. You've heard me preach before, many of my sermons will burn. Many of my motives were wrong when I've done lots of things for Jesus. And I think it applies in this world too. It can be the most amazing thing. And if it's done for wrong motive, it still might have good impact, but eternally it burns.
Right.
So do things right for right motives.
Yeah. So what do you think about, you know, creatives creative and creatives is a buzzword. Mm-hmm. You know, it's à la mode.
Yes, it is.
Particularly with younger people, you know, what are their creative outlets and finding their sort of creative hustle on the side and all this kind of stuff. There's lots of people who are doing that now. But within the church, what do you think are the opportunities for creativity? Maybe there's something that you've longed for, you haven't seen yet, or you feel hopeful about some direction, because there's lots of negative stuff too.
Sure.
but what's a hopeful thing?
Well, I mean, what I love about this church, particularly that you and I work at, is this, first of all, that there's three or four generations here all the time in large representations.
Right. So, babies, grannies.
Everything.
Boomers,
multicultural, multi-generational.
Yeah.
So what I love about that is there's this forced blending that's happening, which is beautiful. And in the middle of that,
what do you call forced blending?
There's a forced blending, and it's not like forced in the sense of like you must sit with this person. It's just when you sit with someone, you're in connect group with someone, you get to know someone.
Yeah.
Which is a rare thing because most churches that are growing tend to be tribal at the beginning, and we're not. So I like that. Mm. In the middle of that, you got a bunch of creatives that are actually multi-generational, which means that there's this whole learning from each other, which I appreciate. I love that in this church, we have the money, the time, the resources, and the openness to say to those who are younger and older, are you creative? We'd love to see you use photography or art, or like, I'm very hopeful about that.
Yeah. Music and media.
Absolutely. Even painting or sculpture. My concern is biblical literacy. Because so you got all this hustling going on the side and oh yeah, I'm going to do this for Jesus. And I'm like, yeah, but actually what you just produced isn't even biblical.
I mean, maybe without using our church as an example, because we're not trying to call people, you know, it would be too close to home, but can you think of an example of some art that you've seen in the world and you thought, isn't that nice, but it's actually not?
I'd have to think about that. What I mean is, I know it's our church, but can I give the example of what we just went through with the graphics?
Oh, yes. Yeah. That's a great, okay, so, that's fine. We're talking about you and I, not people who are listening to the podcast.
No, so we're about to do a three-week series on the Trinity.
Yes.
And so, Joe, I'm sitting in a landmark line ready to go see movies.
Oh, is that where you were?
I was, yeah. And I got the Slack message, and she said, what do you think about this image? And the image, it was great. It was origami based, and it was a crown, a cross, and a dove. And I said,
yeah, three pieces of origami to represent the three.
Yeah, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. And I said, that's awesome. But if it's only that, that's heresy. And she's like, John, I'm just being creative. I'm like, no, that's actually the problem.
Right.
So we had this whole conversation about that's all right as long as all three pieces go back into one thing.
Right. They are not three separate
gods alone
entities. They must actually be one
and three.
And then I was saying, well, what if we have the, you know, the crown that represents the Father, and we unfold the origami, and then we refold the origami into a cross?
And I freaked out more because I said, no.
heresy.
That actually is heresy. That's modalism, where God appears as the Father, and then he stops, and then he's the Son, and then he's Spirit. So this actually shows this is a great example where this unbelievable video direction that's origami based, and we got old, and you'll, if you see it online, maybe Joe can post it later, the video we used, it's old hands, and this young voice, and this really beautiful thing,
and folding these shapes.
Yeah, amazing. And actually turned out probably one of the best videos I've ever seen on the Trinity. But what was interesting is the creative idea actually was communicating something theologically wrong or dangerous.
Right.
And so this is why the interplay between biblical literacy, theological literacy, and art always have to be circling together, or it becomes trouble.
Right. Because of course visuals, they stick with people. And so if we use the visual incorrectly or without enough depth in thought,
right,
it will leave people with an impression of this series. Believe it or not, they may not remember much of what you say in the sermon.
No, I do believe it.
But you know, 6 months from now, the visual, we don't get that visual right in how we show with origami paper what the Trinity is like.
Right, who he is.
It will actually leave people
in a wrong place.
Yes.
So it's just...
So there's power and danger.
Correct. And that's why I think what I love that's happening in our community is there are these centers of of art, and there's these centers of thinking. And like we've said before in other ways, we jokingly say here, you know, I preach like a Baptist, I think like an Anglican, we serve communion in different ways, and we sing like charismatics. If you can pull all that in one church, you'll be fine at C4. And people usually look at us and they go, I think I can understand that, but that shouldn't be. And we go, actually, it should be, because actually that's what the church should look like. So the same here. We want high intellectualism, not smart because I'm smart and you're stupid. Like, no, engaged thinking, biblical literacy, beautiful art, genuine community. Like, we want to put all these things where usually one church does that well only.
Yeah, like there's denominations that are known for that these things.
We're like, no, actually, we're called to do all those things.
Right.
So we're trying, and it's hard.
And maybe we won't get them all right at the same time. I mean, it takes years to develop each area.
That's right. Yeah. And there could be percentiles, right? Mm. But I think at the heart of it, we're trying to do this. Now, how, you know, it's like a music style, though. And just for everyone listening, this is so important. Like, we chose a music style. We don't over-spiritualize a style of worship here. We've chosen this, and this is the style we offer because we can't compete with the radio. You can't compete with Siri.
Yeah.
So the same with art. We've made some decisions because of money and time that say we tend to do this over that.
Right.
It's not saying we don't like that.
Yeah.
It's just,
we just don't have the capacity to create oil paintings for every series.
Correct.
or sculptures. Yeah. I mean, it'd be amazing to do that once a year, but yes, we don't have the capacity for that kind of creative work all the time.
And there's tension even with that among our artists.
Oh, of course. Yeah. Yeah.
What type of art wins?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And people who are amongst us who are creative in a direction that we have chosen not to go in.
Yeah, for a season, it's very
hard. And not because that is bad art. It's just we aren't doing it that way now.
Yeah, so I mean, there's always tension there. And then the other tension we should just be very honest about, and it's true in all nonprofits sectors, is this. Just because you want to volunteer doesn't mean you should.
Mm.
So then there's the question of excellence. So there's the question of theological integrity.
The woman with the great heart, but she's a terrible singer.
100%.
Yeah.
Exactly. So it's like theological excellence, right motives, biblical literacy, and actually, no, you can't do this here because actually we have standards. Right? And some churches don't want to do that, but we've made that decision.
Yeah, and that's offensive to some. You know, I'm sure some people listening are hearing like
arrogance, pride. You
know, yeah.
Yeah, but
well, then it's not about the person you're discipling. It's about the, well.
Well, it's actually both.
Yeah, it's both.
Yep. Yeah, it's just we believe in gift-based ministry, so serve where you're good.
Well, and it's the classic story of the person who goes on American Idol because everybody in their life has told them they're a great singer.
Yeah,
and then they're embarrassed on national television.
Or not, which is even more scary.
Yeah. Yeah. Fair enough. Yeah. Yeah. So, the focus of a lot of my work is under this banner of the Word Made Digital.
Yep.
And it's a play off of the Word Made Flesh out of John 1.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to pivot into that for a few minutes with you. I'd love to talk about this verse out of John, this chapter, John 1. You know, coming out of Genesis 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, you know. And anyways, the Word becomes flesh and blood and dwells among us, or it be in the, I was stumbling there because I wasn't sure if I'd go Message or NIV.
Yeah.
So in the Message, it's the Word becomes flesh and blood and moves into the neighborhood. And so there's my Joanna paraphrase, but it's this beautiful text. But what strikes me as a communications person, as a creative person, is that the choice is to call Jesus the Word. Mm-hmm. Can we talk about that a little bit?
Sure.
You know, there's lots of things that Jesus says he is, like, I am
the bread of life, the glory.
Yep. You could give a longer list than I can, but you know, I am the light of the world, and I am the bread of life, and I am the way, the truth, and the life, and I am. And yet the text starts with the Word.
Yeah.
And so what's the significance of that? Why is Jesus described there as the Word when he's not described as the living water became flesh or the light became flesh?
Yeah, so John was using the Greek idea of logos, right? And what he did is he personified it. And you know, it's really interesting because I'm working on that passage for the next 2 weeks because we're doing the Trinity. And some of the variations in Greek are interesting. It says, you know, it reads like the Word was with God, but actually says the Word was God. Like the way that actually it reads is really intriguing. But at the heart of it, what I love about the incarnation is not that God just moved in the neighborhood. The other word is he tabernacled with us. So it's the idea of God resided in the tabernacle in the temple.
And moved with the people as the people moved.
So there's that actually direct correlation in that those group of verses. But what I love about it is that Jesus was a 33-year-old Jewish guy. Mm. And why I like that is because that is the we see here all the time. Jesus isn't just our Savior and our Lord; he's also our model.
Yeah.
And the incarnation is this unbelievable modeling of God's heart for the world. So, the brilliance of the Christian movement is it is not bound by culture. If you look at Islam, Islam says, you know, God's language is Arabic. And to read the Quran right, you have to read it in Arabic. All the other things are okay, but you know, there's these cultural overtones where they become spiritualized. Our movement says, no, incarnation says, this thing about a seed, the seed doesn't change, but the husk can change all the time. Mm. So the incarnation set up this brilliant sort of like, it's a terrible word, so forgive me, but like parasite's a terrible thing. But it's this idea, you can go to any environment and you can host yourself in other places.
Right.
So I think the incarnation sets us up for this incredible multicultural, multi-generational, and multi-communication strategy in the kingdom where the essence never changes. If you change the essence, that's called heresy. Hell, it's bad. That's serious. That's really serious. But the seed can change. Mm. And so that's why, I mean, I jokingly say, I run a church in the suburbs of Toronto that feels like Starbucks and Walmart. Of course it feels like this, because I'm leading a church in the suburbs of Toronto. I don't expect this style of church to exist in 50 years necessarily.
Right.
And that doesn't threaten me. I've jokingly said to you, you want to see what Hillsong looked like in 580 AD, go to any Orthodox church. They literally enshrined the most progressive, amazing outreach church in 580 AD and said, and it shall ever be like this.
And hence the Orthodox Church.
And I mean, there's more than that. There's theology. Yeah. But I mean, culturally, the expression of it, and they spiritualized it.
Right. What was working and effective to reach people in the 5th century, you're correct. Saying, even in its creative work, like these beautifully ordained buildings.
Ordained buildings and iconography and liturgy. And I know there's theological reasons behind all of that. Some people are going, John, you're like, I know. But my point is they also spiritualize culture. Mm. And that, don't do that. Mm. Don't do that. Mm. Because actually the brilliance is that Joanna can have a job where she's a communications director in her church and we're using this type of media and it's very incarnational for this moment. And it's not saying everything should be thrown away, but everything does have a season or a life.
Right. And so then the Word,
yes.
When the Word becomes flesh and blood, right. It can speak the language of the people.
Right, and it's accessible. And like we always say, the reason why we need pastors and theologians is because we weren't there.
Yeah.
We have to go translate all the cultural nuances that we've lost.
Yeah.
Like I've said from the stage before, if I say in 150 years from now, if I was alive, hey, you want to go on Facebook, everyone's going to go, what's a Facebook?
Yeah.
If I say Facebook right now, everyone knows in their mind without me explaining it what Facebook is.
Right.
So incarnation allows you to speak the language of the people, but Jesus is God in flesh. He is God. He does not change. Mm. Yeah.
Yeah. And so what do you think of all these translations? What I'm speaking about is like there are some people who have made attempts to take the scriptures and translate them into, you know, the hip hop Bible, sure. Or the Passion Translation. I mean, maybe translation is the wrong word.
It is.
But talk to me about how do you feel about those attempts?
I know a lot of people get really nervous about all of that. I don't. One of the reasons I don't is because my doctorate is in missiology, not in theology.
Okay.
So my bias academically is towards mission.
Right.
And outreach and translation. So you know, all these people that argue over the right Bible translation, I just shake my head because a friend of mine, for example, who's a missionary in southern Sudan, 1% of the population right now is literate. Hmm. So argue all you want, but none of them can read. So what my friend did is he raised a bunch of money. He's a Texan, so he could do that. And he raised all this money and he put up radio towers right across southern Sudan. And then he and a group of people who are southern Sudanese retranslated the Bible in song.
Oh,
so
wow.
Every single story in the Bible is to a song that can be memorized and translated.
Beautiful.
So is,
there's creativity,
yeah,
my
but,
goodness.
But is that the gospel? Is that really the word of God? See, that's where this gets, and I'm like, yes. Now, do I think we need to work on literacy and all that? Of course
right.
I do. Do I think there are certain translations that are better? Yes. Are there some bad ones? Absolutely.
Yeah.
But as I said a few weeks ago, would you just actually read the one you've got in your hands and obey it versus
yeah.
arguing half the time?
Yeah.
I know there's big differences.
Yeah.
I understand the difference between the ESV and the NIV. Just don't make the mistake around teachers and theologians to call the message a translation. You will just drive them crazy.
The Eugene Peterson,
yeah,
the message.
Or the passion. It's just not. But it's great and it's fantastic.
Yeah. I mean, it is a way to reach people and to do ministry and
right.
to connect people to.
Yeah, the story.
Yeah.
But sometimes I think that the people who are story oriented need to get to the doctrine. People who are doctrine oriented need to get to the story.
Right.
And there needs to be this balance.
So, I mean, for creatives, mm-hmm. if they were, you know, probably not theologically educated,
yep.
I mean, in a formal way,
yep.
Where do you think they would start? If they were going to take one or two courses at a seminary, or they were going to go online, there's so much online stuff
sure.
to do like a Bible course. Where do you think would be a great place for a creative person to start if they wanted to get that backing to their work?
Yeah, well, I think the categories you really need to think about are hermeneutics. So hermeneutics is the formal study of how you interpret the Bible, interpret scripture. So just like creative people go, in painting, that's impressionistic, that's post-impressionistic, that's modern, that's classic. So in the Bible, there are all these genres of style, of writing. And if you don't know, if you can't actually identify those, you will mistranslate those. So mm-hmm. some of them are literal that move to allegory. Others are allegory that move to literal. This stuff really matters because if the Bible is God's word, you got to handle it right.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we handed a book here all the time called How to Read the Bible for All It's Worth. And it's a great book, introduction to how you deal with a genre. So I would say, learn how to read your Bible right. I think any person who wants to grow in their faith should do a basic systematic theology intro. In the other words, who is God? Who is Jesus? What about creation? What about end times? And where does the family agree and disagree?
Right. So that we don't have a horrible origami mishap.
Correct. Correct. And some of you might be going out there, well, who cares? Well,
right.
But God has revealed himself. So so actually we have to care.
Right.
I know postmodernism has allowed experience to be a great avenue for conversation, but postmodernism is also horrific because it says there's no truth. And there is truth. There's absolute truth. So I would say, Michael Horton's book we use here, 20 Things Every Christian Should Believe, J.I. Packer's little book, Concise Theology. Those could be good introductions. And it's not for you to become some PhD in theology. It's just for you, I'm taking off my glasses. You can't see it. But it's like, this is putting right glasses on so you see clearly.
Right.
And so your art isn't centered in you. Because it's actually
there
not.
There it is.
It's why. Like, your story is important. But it's like I'm going to say, this Sunday we have baptisms happening here, whole whack of them. And I'm going to say when I speak, your story is important, but this isn't about your story. It's about his story.
Right.
Your story is secondary to his story. So your art should be reflecting him first, not you. And this has deeply actually affected me because I'm actually artistically bent. Joe knows this.
Yeah.
I jokingly say I preach like my father paints. If you ever seen my father's paintings, they're huge, large things with big dark clouds and there's light shining through them. And I'm like, I preach like my dad paints, intense and bold, and there's some light in there too. And so I have an artistic thing. But one thing that God convicted me on is I used to use, for example, music to move me while I prepared sermons.
Mm.
But that's not wrong. You know, if you want to feel sad, you put on Sarah McLachlan, like that, all right, or whatever. Like, yeah. The problem with that in my conversation with God was, God said, but that's actually not real power, and that's not really my source of power.
Mm.
So there was this conversation I had with God about the misuse of art to put me in an emotional place to write emotional things.
Interesting.
Where God said, no, actually my spirit's where the power is. So you go to him for this conversation. Those things are important and beautiful, but they can't be the epicenter of your motivation and your inspiration.
Interesting. So now when you're working on sermon material, after the research is done, I imagine you're in like the writing mode,
yeah.
which is the more creative side.
Yeah.
You're saying that you don't use music anymore?
I use it differently.
Okay.
I don't use it to put me in spaces.
I see. Okay.
Because it now maybe I'm the weaker brother in this, and that's okay. I'm good to say that.
No, that's interesting.
But I just think I just think we really need to be careful, because we can suddenly start going not to poisoned wells, but wells that aren't living water, but are stagnant water.
Right.
And some of this
self-sufficient.
100%. Or things that are beautiful, but not capital B beautiful.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. Oh, I didn't know that.
Discovery.
I mean, I often hear music coming out of your office, yep. And it can be anything from Beethoven's Seventh Symphony to Christmas music in July. I mean, it's really, you just have this like ongoing playlist of stuff. I know you love music.
Love music.
And so I didn't realize that there had been sort of this working out of that process for you as you preach.
No, I feel things very deeply. It's the same thing with me in movies. I love movies, but I'm careful what movies I go see.
Mm, yeah.
'Cause sometimes I'm pulled into them and I feel like it almost puts me in another space. I can't get out for a bit. So I'm just wise.
Mm.
Because not all good art is good for you.
Right. I just heard a quote today, listening to a friend, Karen Newhoff's podcast.
Yeah,
and so I would love to tell you where it came from, but all of us can Google it if we really want to find out. And it was, and the gist of the quote was, people in the church who call themselves Christians, they are either missionaries or they are imposters. There's nothing in between. Wow. You are a missionary or you are an imposter. This idea basically... the argument towards you are active in telling people about this Jesus you say that you love, or you don't seem to really love him very much. It's a show. Is it a show for you? Are you an imposter, or is this real? And so, you know, obviously for creative people or people who work in media and art and technology, communications within the church, this sort of broad umbrella, many of those people use their skills outside of the church. Mm-hmm. They're not using it
evangelistically.
Right. Yeah. People aren't painting pictures of Jesus all the time.
Right.
They're working in an ad studio, making an advertisement for Nike or Coca-Cola or something.
Right.
And they still have this skill of art, but they're using it in their workplace.
Yep.
So just as an encouragement to those people, and sort of one of the last things to say, I'd love to hear, you know, for people who are using these skills, art, communication, media technology, but they're not directly doing it for church.
Right.
What would you say to them?
Well, great segue, because after the Trinity series, we're doing 4 weeks on Jesus in the workplace. Because one thing we want to redeem in our community is actually everyone who works outside of a church is just as spiritual and is loved by God just as much as those who work inside. This
yes.
ongoing war between the sacred and secular that comes up in every generation has to be readdressed. How does a stay-at-home mom with three kids feel spiritual? How does an ad exec feel spiritual? How does a lawyer feel spiritual? A nurse? And, you know, the book of Colossians says, you know, we do all things for Christ. And so one of the things I always want to encourage people to do, no matter what they do, is every day when they start the day, see, I'm actually going to do my job as worship to Jesus.
Right.
And that will have a huge impact, because actually your boss is not who you're pleasing anymore. It's Jesus, mm-hmm. which means, by the way, you will not steal. You will not lie. You will not gossip. And you will work your hardest at the product, because you're now doing it for Jesus.
Mm. And that is your missionary work.
So, yeah, well, first of all, you work for the Lord. And I think John Wesley used to say, or something like this, where the first generation of Christians were always the hardest working, because they actually experienced the love of God. It's the third generation of Christians who's lost the connection.
Huh.
So every time a revival took place, work culture goes through the roof in a beautiful way, because people actually honor God with
people get industrious. Is that what you mean?
They do. And huh. they get industrious because they love Christ.
Right.
It's not, I'm going to be a capitalist today. It's like, no, I'm doing all things. I'm going to raise my children for Jesus. I'm going to make this Nike ad for Jesus, whatever. Second thing that's really important, I tell you, is, you know, as a creative person, we desperately need you to live an authentic Christian life, because the creative community is one of the largest communities unreached for Jesus.
Right.
And so if you can be profoundly creative, theologically stable, and still live an authentic life, you're one of the most rare gem missionaries we've got.
Right.
And we really need you.
Right.
We really need you. We don't need all the creatives to leave the industry and come to the church. Actually,
we'd like a few of them. Yeah, I wouldn't mind you joining my team.
Yes. But we need a lot of you to,
of course, a lot of you
to stay.
Yeah.
But the third thing is, as a creative, you're always going to live in the tension between creativity, feeling, and truth. And you've got to make sure that the scriptures and Jesus has the final say on everything.
Mm.
because you artistically will always be tempted with idolatry and not even know it.
Mm.
Just like a lot of people who are high capacity thinkers will be tempted into pride and into
intellectualism.
Well, same thing. It's just this, right? So you've got to really bring it in and under Jesus.
Mm.
And you might lose your job because of it.
Wow. Or you might not be able to do that project except that client.
Exactly.
Because of the work.
Which might cost you.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Well, John, I'd love just to close if you could pray for the people listening.
Yeah, sure.
You know, people who are these things, whether working in the church or out of the church, you know, in the workplace, in their homes, in their communities, people who are creative, wrestling through communications, technology, media in an age that is rapidly changing what that even looks like around them, and facing all these challenges of sin that are the same for every generation.
In every
workplace. And so, let's pray for them together.
Sure. Yeah, thanks, Lord. We can just meet. We claim the scripture that says where two or three Christians are present, Jesus is present. So we know this is a guaranteed place of moment and encounter. Pray for everyone who's working inside of churches, who is volunteering or on staff. I pray for their unity with non-creative people. I pray for their unity with creative people.
Yeah.
I pray that there would be strong relationships even between creatives and non-creatives as they try to present the gospel together. Pray for everyone within the workforce or in university or college or in high school. Pray that you'd let them be a beautiful light for Christ. I pray also they would really grow in their creativity. That they would be the best they could be as you've created them. Also, Lord, simple prayer but honest, help them also know their limits so they're not seduced by a dream or a future they're not supposed to have, so they don't end up bitter. And pray for all of us that we'd live a holy life, a loving life, and we would love the scriptures and submit under them and love Jesus who shows us the Father by the Spirit. Amen.
Yeah, amen. Well, John, if people want to find you, where do they find you? Where would they find you on social media? Let's start there.
So on Instagram at Pastor, oh man, I gotta
remember. I think you're Pastor John, J-O-N, underscore T. Pastor John, underscore T. And where do they hear your teaching?
Yeah, so c4church.com.
And what if they wanted to take a course that you teach?
Oh yeah, so teaching, c4church.com, C4 app. YouTube, we're on YouTube now and also lots of other places.
Yeah, we'll link all these in the show notes.
I do some profing at Tyndale, so I actually teach a course on spiritual dynamics in May, every May or June every year, specifically on spiritual conflict, spiritual warfare, demons, exorcism,
yeah,
all
that
stuff.
Prayer
so
and all
that.
Yeah.
So you can check us out there. And then, of course, you can always hang out at one of our locations at C4.
Yeah. And what about that book?
Yeah. So just finished a whole book and a whole curriculum called Convergence that we're just getting ready to take to some agents. And it's all based on Jesus, not just being Savior and Lord, but model. And what does it mean? How do you combine spiritual gifts, spiritual disciplines, spiritual experiences? How do you find that in Jesus? And why might this be a really significant doorway to church renewal and a post-Christian experience?
Awesome.
Yeah.
Well, thanks so much, John.
Privilege. Thanks, Jill.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that conversation between me and Jon Thompson, my pastor. I know I did. I know that every time I talk to him about these kind of topics, I learn something new. And he kind of comes with a perspective that maybe feels fresh to a lot of us. So if you're looking to get a hold of him or you want to find where he is online, on Instagram, for example, you can find him Pastor John underscore T, like T like Thompson. And I'm going to link some things in the show notes. But coming out soon, he has a book, actually. It's called Convergence. And it's looking at the convergence of spiritual practices, spiritual gifts, and spiritual experiences in the life of a believer and the life of the local church to bring vitality in this new culture, this new time, this post-Christian experience that a lot of us are going through in our churches, in our ministry, in our workplaces. So it's going to be a great book. I can't wait for people to get this in their hands, but it's not available yet. As soon as it's available, I will let you all know on the podcast and tell you how to get a hold of it. Maybe we'll have him back to talk about the book, but we'll give away some copies and all that good stuff when John's book is available. Okay, so next week on the podcast, we have another pastor pastor, but a very different kind of pastor. This is a guy named Kevin Mackins. He's an urban church planter in the city of Hamilton, Ontario. He's kind of known as a bit of a hipster pastor. He does a lot of stuff on YouTube, and he focuses particularly in his church on reaching artists. They see this as a community within the urban context that is not necessarily reached well by some of the other kinds of churches in their city. And so they're doing a lot of things to reach out to artists and creatives in their community. So it's an interesting and fun and dynamic conversation. He's got a little bit of a potty mouth, so you're going to have to watch for that. But you are going to want to listen in next week to what Kevin has to say about arts in the church. Hey, everyone, leave a podcast rating or review. Would love for you to share this podcast with a friend, and we'll see you next Monday with Kevin.
Thanks for listening to the Word Made Digital Podcast with Joanna LaFleur. Head over to joannalafleur.com for more practical tools, interviews, and videos for creatives and communicators. We'd love to help you be the best you can be at communicating the best news in the world. Tap that subscribe button.